Hello and welcome to my second devlog. So today I want to show a couple of things in the editor, and later I'll go into VR and show a couple of the new things that I've done. So as you've seen with the weapon demonstration last time, I implemented a lot of assault rifles mainly. And with this, I also improved the attachment system, in that I actually now have an attachment system, whereas before the meshes were just placed in the weapon blueprint. So just to demonstrate it, let me pull out a weapon actor into the level. So what was important to me is that I can switch the attachments on the instance that are on the level. This way I can quickly test different attachments without having to make a loadout menu or anything. So now that the actor is here in the component outline, you can see that I have a couple of attachments points here. And they are basically components that are children of the child actor component, with a slight change that it limits the selection here. And obviously with stuff like grips and so on, I also implemented some gripping logic. So let's just add a sight to demonstrate it. As you can see, the sight now is properly represented here and spawned. I have currently a bug where I cannot delete this child actor, but for my testing purposes, this is pretty much sufficient. So one thing that you can also see, for example, here, you can see that the grenade launcher isn't placed properly. So this is also fairly easy for me to make adjustments now. Place the attachment point a bit, and once I have something that looks good in game, I can use the settings that I see here and put them into the blueprint so that they're global. So let's zoom into it. Okay, maybe let's give it also a laser. And a light. Okay, so with that done, let's jump into VR. Okay, so here we are in game. As you can see, the weapon is spawned with all the attachments. And obviously it works just like before. What I've also done now that these are actors, I can interact with them by hovering the hand over them and pressing the trigger button. Alternatively, I can also grab the weapon on the secondary slot and use the A and B buttons, or X and Y buttons, in order to toggle either the laser or the light. And with anything else, always hovering over it and pressing the trigger button will activate it in some way. Similarly, with something like the underbarrel grenade launcher, when you grab it by the handle and press the mag release button, it will open the tube. And the tube can be closed by hovering over it and pressing the trigger button. I thought about making this completely physical, but I think there's too much of a danger of the tube being moved when the player wants to insert the magazine. So I made it a button prompt to make it very deliberate. Right now, similarly like the shotguns, you cannot load this, but the logic would be the same. So you have to insert a round in here and then it's loaded. Couple of details now. So previously the buttons for the mag release and bolt release also properly moved the controls on the weapon. In the future, I would like to have hand animations for that if possible, or at least if it makes sense. That would be a detail that is not 100% necessary, but at some point I'd like to do this as a challenge. And also, the trigger now moves, and you have some haptic feedback based on the speed at which you're moving the trigger. One thing, once we look down, we can also see I have now a couple of slots currently visualized by these, how do you say, circles, spheres. These will probably or hopefully be replaced with nothing or holsters. Right now it's good for debugging because I can see how the weapon is placed. One thing you can notice, once the weapon is holstered, you cannot collide with it. This was done because with the physical hands, it would be too easy for them to get stuck on the holstered weapon. So I had to make them overlap. So we are back in the editor. So as you've seen, the attachments are now interactable. And what you've also seen in the demonstration for the weapons were also that I have some magnifying sights. I think the most interesting would be the LPVOs. So let's use an. Where is it? Oh, it's in SIG. So with any magnifying optic, similarly to my traditional FPS project, it's basically this mesh and a scene capture component. So let's jump into the blueprint maybe for a bit. So we have the main mesh for the sight, and then we have a scene capture component which captures onto a render target. And then also for the controls, I have here an VR dial component that comes with the plugin. And then the only thing that's necessary is there's some logic that will turn the scene capture component on and off when the weapon is grabbed or released. And there's also a logic for zooming, which is mainly controlled with this zoom dial curve. This manipulates the FOV of the scene capture component mainly. And the FOV of the scene capture component is also influenced by the distance between the aperture and the eye of the player. And this way, I don't have these effects that make the sight look like it's just the screen projecting whatever the camera is capturing. But based on the distance of the VR cameras or the eyes and the aperture, you also have a different FOV. And so the size of an object isn't that dependent on how close you get a sight to the eye, but rather the proximity of the sight to the eye only manipulates how big the sight picture is in your view. So as you can see, what is typical with my blueprints is they are very minimal, and most of the logic is in C++. So for this, I have my own magnifying sight class, which is also a child of a sight attachment point class. And the only thing you can see here is that here there's a bit of a lookup for the zoom factor based on this VR dial, because this kind of control is special for these LPVOs. And I didn't want to make an LPVO class in C++ just for two or three LPVOs. Maybe at some point I'll move it into a base blueprint or into a dedicated C++ class, but right now this is okay for high iteration. Okay, so let's try it out in VR. Okay, so we're back in VR. I already grabbed the weapon. So let's use this target as a reference. So right now, as you can see by the controls here, I'm at 1x. And the picture is also about the same size as the picture that I see through my eyes. And as I explained, no matter how far away or how close the side is to my eyes, it doesn't change the zoom factor, or at least the perceived zoom. In a lot of games, it is possible to get the side as close as possible to your eye. And because it's just a picture, it will make the picture bigger because you're getting closer to the picture. So this way, the only control is how much of your view is the side. So with the VR dial from the plugin, it's just basically a control that you can grab and rotate. So I can change the zoom. If I look through it, you can also see it changes instantly. So I can go to 4x. And it should be about 4x the size. Since this is a first focal plane optic, the reticle also zooms with the image. I don't know if I will have bullet physics at some point, but in that case, I will also calibrate the bullet physics so that the markings on the reticle can be used. Yeah. One experimental thing that I'm also working on is night vision. Currently, I don't have any model for a night vision optic. Would be cool to have it interactable and pull it down. But I see to what extent I can do it. Right now, I can only hover the hand over my head, press the trigger, and I'll be in night vision mode. In night vision, the laser will also have a visible beam. And that's basically it. And as you can see, without night vision, the beam is invisible, but the dot bar from the laser can be seen. I'm also playing around with DLSS, and here you can see one of the weaknesses, probably because DLSS doesn't have a lot of information now in this scene, so it's mostly black, and because of this you have a lot of ghosting. Even in general, the small laser dot is way too small to generate proper velocity data for DLSS, so you can see a lot of ghosting. If you also look at the edges of a weapon, sometimes you can see some DLSS artifacts. This is mostly an issue with iron sights on pistols, but it's generally good enough and the performance gain is pretty good. So another thing you've seen is the corner shot. The corner shot, my goal was that the pistol attached to the corner shot is not part of the corner shot weapon itself, but the same pistol that is placed in here and fully modular so that I can change also the kind of pistol that is attached in here. And so it's basically just also a child actor attached to this corner shot. This model needs to be reworked because it has a couple of weaknesses in VR. For example, this part here, which you couldn't see in the traditional game isn't modeled at all. There's also here a problem with the normals and here. So I will make a remake of this model. There are a couple of things that are also wrong. For example, here in the front, both the IR and visible laser aren't there, and the lamp is too big, and the stock is fairly wrong. But nevertheless, functionally it's implemented now. The techniques I'm using are the same as with the magnifying sight. So I have a scene capture component here in the front, and it activates when I grab the weapon. Because this is the same weapon as this one, I can just load the same magazines in here and interact with all the controls. One big question was, how do I realize the mag release? And my decision right now was that the mag release is activated by hovering the hand over the weapon, or kind of close to the weapon, and pressing the mag release button, and this will eject the magazine. And then regarding controls, if you grab the handle here and press the trigger button, it will activate it. And at that point, you can rotate the corner shot. It's a bit awkward in VR, but you will get some sort of technique at some point that will help you make it easier by using both hands. Usually you have some weird angles. You can also cheat a bit, because once the controller is attached, the rotation of the actual controller isn't important anymore, but only the positions. And if you just press the trigger button while the corner shot is looking to the side, it will reset to the base position. At the moment, the screen and the stock aren't interactable. It wouldn't make much sense in terms of gameplay, but generally in VR, my feeling is it's very satisfying if you think, hey, can I do this? And it works in VR. So I will probably make everything that looks interactable, interactable, as long as it doesn't cause too much work. Then one thing that is easy to demonstrate with the AK. So previously with the magazines, at some point they would lock into a specific path that you can still manipulate with your hands. And what is now new with mostly the AK or the P90 is that I also have a rotation component. So when I move along this path, the rotation of the magazine is changed. And so with this, I have this rocking motion when inserting the AK magazine. There's also now a bit of a difference where the controls are. So with an AK, you have to grab the magazine and press the magazine release button with the hand that is grabbing the magazine. And with any AR style weapon, you have to press the mag release button with the hand that is holding the grip. And so there's now a distinction in how you control the weapons. For a long time, I was thinking about not doing this and having very consistent controls. But I think it's easy enough to learn. Otherwise, maybe I have to think of some sort of tutorial system or level that has enough hints for players in order to operate all the weapons. But I think this is an interesting point for balancing the different weapons and giving players a lot of options depending on how their preferences are. Also, for anybody who is into more milsim style games, this is probably a change that they will like. Another thing, I was asked in the comments how I did the magazines. So let's take a short look into them. So let's start first with the basic standard NATO magazine. So in terms of setup, it's just a static mesh for the magazine. I have a couple of helper components here, like a grip slot component. So it's basically a scene component that gives me the position where the hand should be located. And this attached origin is basically an helper position that I can use to adjust how the magazine is attached to the weapon so that I don't have to make the changes in the mesh and can do them easily by placing this component in this blueprint. Then I have a collider. This one detects if the magazine comes close to the magwell. And then I have an instant static mesh for the rounds. Right now, this is completely unoptimized. An optimized version would also have a limiting function so that for these opaque magazines, not all rounds are rendered. And then the follower itself is also a separate mesh in here. So in order to make it easier, let's make it transparent. I thought I had some material. Yeah, let's use this one. So let's show functionality first. So I have a couple of parameters here that I can use in order to change the way the magazine is stacked. So I have a couple of flags for switching the order from left, right, then whether it is double stack or not. And I also have a couple of controls, so the radius of the rounds. This I can use in order to control the distance between each round. So let's change it a bit. Then the curve radius. This is the radius of the curved section here. Then an index where the curve starts. So as you can see, when I decrease it, you can see that the curve starts earlier. And so on. So again, my main goal is always with these things that I'm able to do a lot of adjustments in the editor and see them. And then I have here a construction script that will update my instance static mesh. And I think this is the easiest way to show how it works in principles. So because I'm in the construction script, I don't care about performance. So I just clear all the instances in the instance static mesh. And then I go into the for loop that loops over the number of current ammunition that I have, and then obtains based on the index a transform for the round, and then adds the instance at that transform. And then when it's done with the loop, it will update the follower location. And as you can see, let's change the number of instances here. This is also properly represented, and I can also change my logic, debug my logic by changing the values here and see if it works properly in game. And this is a pretty good representation for that. So for transparent magazines, there's a bit of an addition. So I have a couple of support meshes because transparency is a bit of a challenge in Unreal. And I also have a spring component, which is a skeletal mesh, which has a morph target that I can use to control the spring compression. If you want to know how to create such a morph target, look for tutorials on YouTube. It's fairly easy once you get it. When I did it in Blender, I created a couple of bones and rigged it to this spring, and then used the bones in order to easily deform the spring to the desired end position. And then I just made this armature modifier my morph target. And with this morph target, I can also control, where is my, yeah, can also control the deflection of the spring based on how much ammunition you have in the magazine. The logic itself is now mostly in C++. And there's, as you can see here, this function getRoundTransform that you have seen in the blueprint construction script, and also updateFollowerLocation. So let's start with updateFollowerLocation first. And as you can see, it's not that much of a complex function. Here I just set the morph target value based on the current number of rounds that I have in the magazine. And it's basically a linear curve. So this would be the input, the X value. Then you have a slope that it's multiplied with, and then I have a bias. And obviously this part of the function is only performed when there is actually a spring component. Similarly, when there is a follower mesh component, it will get the armor transform of the last round and use this location as a basis in order to place the follower. And so let's go into this function get armor transform. So here's the main logic how the rounds are placed. And in order to make it easy for me to configure, as you've seen, there were a lot of physical parameters. So what is the radius of the round? What is the radius of the slope? When will the curve, and when does the curve start? And so here you have that logic. Currently, for double or single stack, I only have this binary condition where I have, is it double stack or not? But I want to make this in the future a value between 0 and 1, so that I have also some sort of semi double stack magazines and so on. Okay, that's it for this time. I hope you found it interesting, especially with this little change where I also was in the editor now. If you have questions, feel free to write them in the comments, and I wish you a nice day. Bye.